Hello, everyone. I'm Edward McNair, the Executive Director of NANOC. And today with us, we have Melchior Ammons, and he will be talking about the state of router security and kind of an introduction to RPKI. So sit back and enjoy, and there'll be Q&As to follow. Thank you all for participating.
Hello. My name is Melchior Ammons. I'm a consulting engineer with Juniper Networks. And one of my interests and hobbies is around the topic of routing security. So today we'll be exploring what is routing security and which mechanisms are available. And we'll also touch on the latest innovation in that sense, RPKI, and we'll take a look at what's next. So here's our agenda for today. As I mentioned, so we'll start with what is the current state of affairs? Where are we on routing security? What do we have available? We'll look at a few problem statements. What is the issue with the current mechanisms we have? Then we'll touch on RPKI. So I'll explain what RPKI is, how to implement RPKI, and obviously how it can help you protect your network. We'll also look at some other components of RPKI validators, and I'll touch on some of the implementation tips and tricks, and I have some configuration to share, so you get an idea how you can configure RPKI. And then we'll look at some other work currently happening in IETF. In other words, what is after RPKI origin validation? And I have some slides on statistics and additional resources. So let's take a look at the current situation. Some of you might know these two napkins. This is what originally started as what we currently know as BGP version 4. This is basically BGP version 1, or in other words, the two napkin protocol. This is how BGP started 30-ish years ago. And the issue is that back then, everyone knew each other, right? So if I would be operating a network and you would be operating a network, we would know each other. And so if there would be an issue with my network or your network, we knew how to reach each other. Because of that fact, there wasn't really a need for routing security because you obviously trust your friends. Unfortunately, today, or maybe fortunately, the networks have become so big and so the internet that we do not know each other anymore. And so we do need some mechanisms. Obviously, in the perfect world, we have on our left side a innocent user, and she's trying to reach a website which is hosted on IP address 198.51.100.10, and that is obvious, that is hosted on the other side of the internet in the data center. And the reason why the service provider of our innocent user knows how to reach that destination is obviously because of this routing protocol, BGP. And in very short explanation how that works, the data center announces from its border routers a IP prefix, as you can see, 198.51.100/24 from a autonomous system number. As I said, in the perfect world, our innocent user is obviously able to reach that, and that is because of BGP. And the reason why that actually works quite well today is because we, since BGP version 1, we created lots of mechanisms and ways to filter all these announcements. So obviously, probably everyone who operates a network has these filters in place. So we have prefix filters that specify what announcements I accept from my peers and my transits. There are mechanisms like a peer lock, that defines which announcements I should receive from which peer. There's a mechanism called Big Networks Filter that basically states that I will never accept a tier one announcement or a tier one ASN behind a tier two or a peer ASN. In other words, it would be really awkward if you peer with a tier two network and the tier two would provide transit services for a tier one network. Then there's obviously Bogon ASN and Bogon prefix filtering. For example, RFC 1918 prefixes and obviously private ASNs. You could filter on a long ASN path. The question and the interesting discussion around that always is, what is a long ASN path? If you look at average ASN path in the internet, it's maybe six-ish. But because of AS prepending, an AS path could be 10 or 20 ASNs. You could safely state that an AS path over 50 ASNs would be safe to filter. Obviously, we filter on small prefixes, so everything in IPv4 between /25 and up to /32. And there are databases like IRR that you can use to build your filter policies. So all good, right? You know most of your customers and peers, and you have strict filters in place, so you only accept from your customers their own routes, and from peers, you only accept the routes they or the announcements they have published in, for example, IRR or in their AS set. However, lots of the filtering we currently use, like prefix filters, don't care about the origin ASN, right? So the prefix filter only looks at the specific prefix. It also doesn't care about the AS path. Peer lock doesn't cover every network and is arbitrary. Same with big networks filter, because what is currently a big network, right? Previously, it was really simple. There were a handful of tier one service providers, and those were the big networks. But today, Google, Amazon, Microsoft, Facebook are considered tier one networks as well. Filtering out /24s, for example, or 25s, or even 32s could be an issue for DDoS mitigation. And obviously, there are downstream customers that are using private ASNs. And so on. And the biggest issue probably is that if you use IRR databases, there is lots of outdated or stale data in those databases because it's up to the prefix or the resource user to keep the data in that database current. And unfortunately, in many cases, it's outdated. And specifically, IRR data is far from 100% accurate. If you look at this, these two maps, you can see on the left side that it's a projection of the RIPE IRR database that is pretty accurate in Europe, Russia, and Africa, and North America. However, in Asia, it's far from accurate. Then on the other hand, there's a commercial IRR database, RADB, which is not 100% the opposite, but it is pretty accurate in North America and in Asia, but it's far from accurate in, for example, Russia. So that is a big issue, right? So because in this case, which database are you going to trust and are you going to use? Till what extent would you want to use that data? Because it's not accurate enough. And so because of that, lots of BGP hijacks are happening. What is a BGP hijack? It's basically a prefix that is announced by a network that it should not announce. So in the majority of cases, it's obviously fat fingers. One and two are pretty close on the keyboard, so it's really easy to make a mistake in an IP prefix, for example, or what happens in many cases is that You provide transit to a stop network, so a tier 3 network, and your filters are not strict enough. And the tier 3, who maybe BGP routing isn't his or her core business, make a mistake and you propagate that mistake. In some cases, it's obviously an intentional hijack, and we'll get to how that looks like. On average, I think basically every month there is a currently a big hijack. Right, if you look at Twitter or LinkedIn, etc., there are many hijacks going on. So to take a closer look at maybe one of the most famous hijacks. This is actually already, I think if I remember correctly, 2 years ago. There is this website, which is called myetherwallet.com. And it's basically used as a virtual wallet for cryptocurrency. So what happened in this case? The DNS servers that resolve myetherwallet.com are hosted by Amazon's Route 53 service. And as you can see, the prefixes that in which the DNS servers live, 205.251.192/23, should be announced by AS16509. However, at one point, a hijack occurred. And what happened is the hijacker started announcing more specifics, right? As you can see on the right side, instead of the /23, hijacker started announcing 2/24s. And because the nature of how BGP works, and more specifics are preferred, all traffic was now redirected to our hijacker. In this case, it didn't really matter from which ASN it was announced, because there was no mechanism in place to check the announcements. So what happened here is our innocent user is now trying to connect to myetherwallet.com because she wants to transfer cryptocurrency. And instead of ending up at the myetherwallet.com website, she ended up at a spoofed website. Obviously, you then get a certificate error, as you can see in the background. However, lots of innocent users on the internet have no idea what a certificate error means. And they just go to this website to transfer cryptocurrency. And what will they do? Click on continue or next to do their business. And so the impact in the end was that many myetherwallet.com users ended up at a spoofed website. And the reason because of that was that a couple of networks like Google Hurricane and some others accepted the hijack. Luckily, there were a few that blocked the hijack, NTT, Cogent, and Level 3, and Equinix, because they obviously had they have probably stricter filters. And the only reason why the hijack was unnoticed for only 2 hours is because the spoofed DNS servers only answered DNS requests for myetherwallet.com and not for other domain names. So they could have done the hijack maybe a bit smarter. in the end, there was a quite a number of cryptocurrency stolen. I'm not sure how much it is, somewhere between, as you can see, 400,000 and $17 million. But it's a really nice example and probably one of the most concrete examples if you look at what the impact financially was. So if we look at what happened here, to make it a little bit more visible, our innocent user again tries to reach this website in the data center. However, at one point, our malicious actor started advertising a more specific. And as I mentioned, by nature, BGP now prefers the more specific prefix. And that one is installed and announced to the ISP of our innocent user. And so the traffic, instead of ending up in a data center, now ended up with our malicious actor. And as you can see, we now have a man in the middle attack. That is basically what happened. Somewhat more recent BGP hijack with a little bit different intention happened on February 1st, 2021, where the Myanmar army took power in the coup against the government. And what happens a lot in cases like this is that you obviously want to block social media. So they did. So they instructed the national ISP to blackhole Twitter's IP addresses. Basically, they set a static route to they injected a static route and tried to blackhole the traffic. However, because their export filters were not strict enough, they started advertising that blackhole route. And as you can see on the right side, originally this prefix should have been announced by AS13414. Because of the black hole route, this ISP now started to advertise that same prefix from AS136168, which is their ASN. This was an unintentional BGP hijack, but with quite some impact, because quite a few ISPs and upstreams of this ISP accepted the hijack. In total, there were five peers that accepted the hijack. If they would have implemented this thing, which is called, or if they would have created ROAS, which is part of RPKI, we'll get to that, then the impact would have been much less much smaller. So in this case, Twitter should have taken some actions to limit potential hijack. Obviously, this wasn't, as I mentioned, an unintentional hijack. The intention obviously was to only blackhole Twitter inside the country, but it quite nicely shows how easy it is to create a hijack on the internet. So let's see how we can prevent these BGP hijacks. There is a mechanism which is called the Resource Public Key Infrastructure, or in short, RPKI. And we can use RPKI to validate or to perform origin validation. What is BGP origin validation using RPKI? It's basically a method to cryptographically sign routes that associate a prefix with an originating AS number. And you might now think, but that's what I can do in IRR. Yes, that is true. In an IRR database, you can make statements about your resources. However, the issue is that in some of the databases, I can create statements about resources of which I'm not the legitimate holder. In other words, there are IRR databases where I could make statements about your resources. And the beauty of RPKI is that the only one who can create statements in the RPKI database is the legitimate resource holder. And that makes it 100% trustable, because the only statements are in are statements about resources from the resource holder. And so all five IRRs, EFRINIC, APNIC, ARIN, LECNIC, and RIPE, have a method for their members to create those statements. And such a statement is called a ROA, a Route Origin Authorization Record. And the reason why you should trust this for your filtering is because it's, as I mentioned, a statement created by the legitimate resource holder, but also because it is cryptographically signed. In other words, you can verify end-to-end if the statement is what was the original statement. And so that is basically the biggest difference between IRR and RPKI. I already mentioned this. With IRR, most operators don't 100% know for sure if the statement is what the original resource holder his intention was. With RPKI, there's proof that it is the statement of the resource holder. So you can verify end-to-end, and you can be sure that whatever statement is in the RPKI database, that it is the intention of the resource holder. So what does the differences mean? Obviously, you cannot, so we already saw trust IRR 400%. Right, so you can use IRR-based filters for peers and customers, but you cannot apply it to tier one providers, for example, because of the fact that it's not 100% accurate. With RPKI, you are sure that you're honoring the legitimate prefix owner's wishes. So if you look at the order of filtering, I would definitely recommend to first filter on RPKI information and then on IRR-based information. So let's see how to create those route origin authorizations. This is a screenshot from the right database. I'm in the right region, so that's the place where I create those ROAS. And at the right RPKI dashboard, it looks as follows. You currently see the BGP announcements for my prefixes, the prefixes of which I'm the legitimate holder of. So I have one IPv6 prefix and two IPv4 prefixes. And they are announced from AS34562. Now, if you look at the second screen, based on those announcements, I can create the ROAS. And a ROA consists of an AS number, a prefix, and a max prefix length. And what that means is I create a statement here because I'm the legitimate resource holder of, for example, prefix 91217235.0/24. And my statement here, which I created, is that prefix with that specific length, /24, should be announced from AS34562. The most specific length allowed is the max length I can configure. So for example, if you look at the /22, that's the prefix I have. And I specified the max length 22 as well, but I could put in 24 here. That basically means that everything, including and up to 22, 23, and 24, are allowed to be advertised from AS34562. There is a thing you need to keep in mind. If I would create that statement here, that also means that if I myself are not advertising more specifics, so I only advertise the aggregate, that if someone would hijack my ASN, so starts advertising routes from 34562, and for example, 45.141.17.0/24, that would be a valid announcement. So be very careful with setting that most specific length allowed. If you don't advertise more specifics and do not have the intention to do so, then I would definitely recommend to keep that /22. In other words, create a specific ROAS as possible. So if I would advertise out of the 22, 124, then it would be better to create a ROA for the 22 and for that specific 24 instead of creating a, let's say, wider ROA. So how does it work? Here you see schematically how it works. On the left side, we have the IRR's database. Again, in my case, that's RIPE. RIPE has a database with all these prefix and ASN combinations, which are called the ROAS. The ROAS are cryptographically signed. And I can now download those ROAS onto a piece of software, which is called a validator. And we'll get to validators later on. And what the validator does, it downloads all these ROAS from the five IRRs. it checks the cryptographic the chain and so checks if the ROAS are valid, cryptographically valid. Then it creates a database of VRPs, validated ROA payloads, and those can be downloaded by our router and used to perform what is called origin validation. The reason of using a validator is because we do not want to burden the internet routers with the process of validating the crypto cryptographic part, because obviously that would potentially be a high load on the router's control plane. So again, what is in a ROA or in a VRP, a validated ROA payload? It's the originating ASN, it's the prefix and its length, the max length, as I mentioned, keep that as tight as possible. So in this case, I advertise 24 and I put the max length to 24 as well. And the TA, the trust anchor, in this case is RIPE. Obviously, if you're with Aaron, then the TA is Aaron. What next? As I mentioned, the router downloads this list of VRPs from the validator and uses that list, that database, to validate BGP announcements it receives. And now there's three different outcomes. If I receive an announcement from my BGP neighbor that matches with a VRP, so the origin ASN matches, the prefix and the length matches, and the max length matches, then the outcome is a valid announcement. If, for example, the originating ASN or the prefix length doesn't match, it's an invalid announcement. If my BGP announcement does not have a match with a VRP in the database, and that is currently still around 70% of the internet, then it's an unknown. So those are the three states of origin validation. So let's look at an example. In this case, my router received two VRPs, one IPv4 and one for an IPv6 prefix. And I received from my BGP neighbor an update about prefix 172.48/24 with originating from AS555. Now, if I match that against my VRP database, I do not see a match for the prefix, which means that it's not found or unknown. Second example, in this case, we receive a BGP update 123/16 from originating ASN 444. And if we look at our database of VRPs, we now see that we do have a match for prefix 123/16. And it falls within the max length, that's /16. And the originating ASN matches with the VRP. So in this case, it's a valid announcement. And the third example, you can almost guess it already. We again receive a prefix update, a BGP update about prefix 123/16 from originating ASN 123. And we do have a match on the prefix 123/16. It falls within the max length, which is 16. However, the originating AS isn't correct. So this could be, again, fat fingers or intentional. But according to RPKI origin validation, this is an invalid announcement because the origin ASN doesn't match. So how does it look like in the perfect world routing? Our router in the middle receives a route advertisement for 198.51.100/24 from AS64496. And what it does now, if I have origin validation activated or configured, it checks that announcement against the VRP database, the validation database. And in this case, it is a perfect match, right? The prefix matches, the origin ASN matches, and the prefix length matches. So in this case, we would accept this announcement. Now what happens if we receive an invalid announcement, in this case 198.51.100.6.24 from AS65536. We again match the prefix against the validation database. The prefix matches. The origin ASN matches. However, the prefix length doesn't match, right? We expect a 24. However, we receive a 25. And this is a hijack, right? Because it's a more specific that would normally be accepted by BGP and probably installed because the more specific wins. However, as there's no match with our record in the validation database, we could configure our router to not accept this route advertisement because it's an invalid advertisement. If we would have accepted this, obviously our innocent user would have ended up, probably ended up somewhere else. Now that we filtered it out, our innocent user still ended up at the correct website, probably. So to summarize it, RPKI is a mechanism that contains statements about resources, which are 100% sure to be put in there by the legitimate resource holder. In other words, if obviously the crypto check on the validator, etc., is done correctly as well, then my router can make routing decisions based on the information that is in the RPKI database. And it's 100% to be trusted. And that is, again, the biggest difference with IRR. So let's take a look at RPKI validators. As I mentioned, the validator is a piece of software that runs, in the majority of cases, off-box. There are some vendors that allow allow operators to run containers, for example, on the router's control plane. So there could be options to run a validator on-box, but normally, or in a lot of cases, it's a piece of software that runs on a server. So what it does, again, it downloads all these ROAS from the five IRRs, checks if the cryptographic chain is still valid, and then creates, based on those ROAS, database with VRPs, validated ROA payloads, which then can be downloaded to the router with a protocol which is called RPKI RTR. Again, and I think I mentioned this already, so I won't spend much time on this. So there were three, let's say, main go-to validators: Routinator, OctoRPKI, and the RIPE RPKI validator. Currently, and this slide is even outdated already, previously I would have told you the reason why I do not recommend RPKI validator from RIPE anymore is because RIPE announced that they stopped their development and support for the validator. I think somewhere end of June, if I remember correctly. So your options would have been Routinator and OctoRPKI. However, Cloudflare announced that they will probably stop with supporting OctoRPKI as well, because the lead developer for OctoRPKI left Cloudflare. So currently the, let's say, most mature and best supported validator available is Routinator from NLNet Labs. I have to say there are other initiatives, and you see a few mentioned here, like Fort and Ripstar and RPKI Client. However, they are either still in beta or maybe not that well supported. So my recommendation currently would be, if you're, let's say, in the market for a validator, to definitely take a look at Routinator. Also, because Routinator is really easy to install. Obviously, if you would want to run it in a production environment, there's more things to to look at and to think about in terms of security, etc. But if you want to get started, it's just these few lines which you can see here on the slide that help you set up and install Routinator. These are basically all the steps you need to do. Once you've done this, you can start configuring your router. So let's look at implementation. I'll start with a few, let's say, tips and tricks, and then we'll look at how to configure RPKI origin validation on my employer's routers. So the strategy to implement RPKI, obviously you would want to run at least two validators. One is none, so for redundancy you want to have two. It depends a little bit on the scale of your network. If you want to run two for your whole network, or maybe two per region, or per geo territory. For a network that is not, let's say, spread around the world, two would be a good number. You obviously want to configure sessions and validation on all your border routers, right? If you would only perform origin validation with, let's say, half of your routers, then obviously the other half would still accept announcements. You want to make sure that all your routers get the updates from the validators themselves. Then obviously you want to configure filters on all your external BGP sessions, right? As I mentioned, same goes if you configure half your routers, same goes for if you would filter on only two out of your four transits, for example, right? You can reject RPKI invalids on two of your four transits, but if you still accept them on the other two, then IBGP will happily make sure that your other routers will still have invalid routing information. And from a, let's say, implementation strategy, there is a few things you want to think about in order of enabling filtering. For example, start with transits is an easy one, because probably all your transits will already perform RPKI origin validation. At least the larger tier ones like AT&T and NTT, etc., have implemented RPKI origin validation. Then enable it on your peers. Lots of peers, lots of route servers on Intel exchanges are already performing RPKI origin validation. And the last set you want to configure origin validation on is obviously your downstream customers. That the reason why is because you first want to get some experience with RPKI before you start filtering on your customers and you take them off the internet. They would probably not like it because that's what they pay you for. And what I've noticed in conversations with customers and others is that it could take, depending obviously on the number of downstream customers you have, it could take quite some time to work with them to make sure that they all have their ROAS in place and all cleaned up their export policies. Because again, you do not want to black hole their announcements. Tips and tricks. I already mentioned implement RPKI validation on all upstreams. If there's a single one where you have not implemented it, then IBGP will happily announce all the invalids to the routers that are actually filtering. The only way to deal with RPKI invalids is to reject them. The reason why this is in, because there is still documentation out there, also from my employer, that suggests to lower the preference on RPKI invalids. The idea behind that is that if you lower the preference, then the correct route with the higher preference is installed. That is true, as long as the prefix length is the same. But as we saw in lots of cases of hijacks, the prefix length is obviously a more specific. So in that case, it doesn't matter if you lower the preference, obviously, because the more specific still win, will still win. So the only way to deal with RPKI invalids, again, is to reject them. The good thing is that for the majority of RPKI invalids, there is a less specific route available. That makes sense. It's logic as well, because, for example, if I have a /22 and I assign 24s to my customers, but my expert filters are not strict enough, then I will, next to my 22, also advertise these 24s. But it wouldn't really matter if you would filter out those 24s, because you still have the aggregate route, the 22. There is the fourth bullet point. Make sure to reject RPKI invalids on outbound sessions. There is a RFC that describes this, which was produced in IETF, I think, last year. However, it's not implemented by many vendors yet. But if you have the option to filter RPKI invalids on outbound sessions, then that would definitely be recommended, because you could also make mistakes yourself, obviously. And the last bullet point, train your support staff. Obviously, if a customer files a ticket or phones up your NOC and tells them, hey, I cannot reach destination X, but the rest of the internet works, then it isn't probably the first fault of the folks in the support folks or in the NOC to think about RPKI invalids. So you might, at the point where you start rejecting those invalids, explain that to your staff as well, so they that does ring a bell when someone calls them. I used Juniper examples because that's easiest for myself, but in general, this works for every vendor, whether you have Cisco, Arista, Nokia, Bird, many BGP implementers have the code done for RPKI. There's lots of documentation available as well. But as I work for Juniper, I use this as an example. So if you want to configure this on Juniper, check out these three PRs before you start configuring RPKI, because you want to run a version that does not contain these PRs. But in basic, the steps are first, configure the session with the RPKI validator. As I mentioned, that is using the RPKI RTR protocol. And what happens if you configure these couple of lines? Your router will start populating the validation database. Nothing happens yet. The only thing, if you commit this, these few lines, then you will have a populated validation database. Then the next step is to actually use that information in your validation database. And you do that by configuring policy. As you can see, this policy consists of four parts. The first three parts are defining the outcome of the validation process. So the first one is, if you receive a route via BGP and it matches with the validation database and it is a valid match, then you mark the route as valid and you tag a community, and you add the community origin validation state valid. The second part, obviously, is for unknown routes. So you receive a route that does not match with anything in your validation database. Then the validation state is obviously unknown, and you add this origin validation state unknown community. And the third option, obviously, is for invalid announcements. You could argue if you want to add a community because you want to reject that route, but I have to say this step is still totally non-intrusive, because this doesn't do this doesn't filter anything. It just tags routes. So it sets the validation state for the route and it adds a community to it. And the third step is to start rejecting invalids. And this is an intrusive step, obviously, because when you enable this, you start actively rejecting those routes. So RPKI region validation solved all issues, right? Well, not really. Why? Because there's still an option, and I already mentioned it, where someone would start advertising your prefixes with a correct prefix length, but also from your ASN. In other words, if someone hijacks your ASN and he advertises a prefix for which you've created a ROA, then he has a valid announcement. It is quite hard to do because you would need to find upstreams that allow you to advertise a ASN which is not yours. But with some transit providers, that would be possible. So there's work in IETF trying to address this problem. There's basically two drafts currently, which is ASPA and ASCONES. But first, let's look at what happens. In this case, our innocent user is again trying to reach a website in the data center. But now our malicious actor starts advertising a prefix which has the same prefix length as your prefix, and he announces it from the same ASM. So in this case, it depends if our innocent user ends up in the data center or at your malicious actor. And that is dependent on, obviously, the AS path, right? So as long as the data center has the shortest AS path, it'll win. However, if the malicious actor has a shorter AS path, obviously our SP or the SP of the innocent user will accept that announcement. So the trick here is to make sure that you have the shortest AS path. Obviously, that doesn't always work in practice. So again, there's two drafts in IETF trying to address this, ASPA and ASCONES. And in short, basically what ASPA describes is a mechanism that is like RPKI origin validation. So in other words, if I'm the legitimate holder of AS1, I create a statement in the RPKI database that basically says my ASN might be or may be announced by AS2 and 3. So I define basically who my upstreams are. ASCONES addresses it from a different angle. ASCONES basically creates a cone where I am the SP and I create a cone that includes all my downstream ASs. So in other words, if I'm AS1, I can make a statement that says in my cone are AS2 and 3. So basically this looks very familiar or looks very the same if you're familiar with AS sets. So I create an AS set where I make a statement that I can tell these ASNs are my downstream ASNs. Both have their pros and cons. Currently, it looks a little bit as if ASPA is a little bit more favored over ASCONES, but ASCONES would be really handy, for example, for large service providers or folks who are familiar with RPSL, for example. But there's also still BGP-SEC. The question I got a lot, so that's the reason why I put in this slide, because there's always someone who asks, but why haven't we done BGP-SEC yet? In theory, BGP-SEC is a really good solution. However, it hasn't been implemented or used yet in the field because you burden the router's control plane, right? What BGP-SEC does is basically if I'm the top router, so NAT1, I sign that my AS path is NAT1 and with this network. And what NAT2 does, it says, okay, I've checked that and it is correct. And I add my AS path or my AS to the path, and I add my signature as well. And so you can imagine if you're downstream 4 or 5 networks, then it becomes quite interesting to do all that verification, especially because that is done on the router's control plane. There are discussions going on because routers today are so powerful and have really powerful CPUs that it might still be interesting to look into, but this was always the reason why BGP-SEC hasn't really seen the light. So until we have better solutions, the best way to prevent AS hijacking is to make sure you have the shortest AS path, or in other words, peer with as many networks as possible. I understand there could be commercial reasons or political reasons for not doing so, but technically, as long as you peer with as many networks as possible, you have sort of first hop AS path validation, because no one will win from the first hop, obviously. So some statistics, where are we with implementation? This graph is unfortunately already a year old, but it shows that since, let's say, 2018, there's quite a nice uptake in adoption. So here's a few networks mentioned that have implemented RPKI. By now, the majority of large cloud providers, Google, AWS, have also implemented RPKI, origin validation. So that's a really good sign. Unfortunately, the number of BGP routes covered by ROAS is still only up to around 30-ish%. So still 72% of the global routing table isn't covered by ROAS. And I want to state here that if you consider implementing RPKI origin validation or create ROAS, you can start with either one of them, right? So you could create ROAS already, but do not perform origin validation yourself. But the good thing is that if you create ROAS for your resources, that at least others can verify your announcements. So obviously, the more ROAS that are created, the better others can verify all the announcements. So additional resources, there is a couple of really interesting pages to be found on the topic of routing security. I think rpki.readthedocs.io is probably the most complete resources. It is maintained by Nelnet Labs, who also created Routinator, the validator. However, rpki.readthedocs.io is covering much more than that. So it's a really good place to get started. There is also obviously vendor documentation. Again, I mentioned Juniper here because that's what I'm familiar with, but deployment guides, white papers are also available for Cisco, for Nokia, and other vendors. And a lot of that is to be found also on rpki.readthedocs.io or on the RIPE website, ripe.net/rpki. That's really good documentation. The RPKI monitor from NIST, they recently updated that. It's really interesting. That's where I got the graph from, which you saw on the previous slide. Again, links to the RPKI validators. And there's a day one book, which I co-authored on deploying BGP routing security. It is a Juniper-specific book, but the concepts obviously work for all other vendors as well. So it's sort of a quick getting started guide for BGP routing security. And any questions, comments, discussion, feel free to ask them now or reach out to me via email, LinkedIn, Twitter, etc.
Melchior, thank you for that wonderful conversation. I appreciate you taking the time. I think that we have a question from the audience from regarding BGP. Could you go ahead and try to answer that question?
Yeah, sure. So the question is, would BGPSec be similar to DNSSec? In short, yes. So for those who are not familiar with DNSSec, I'm not a DNS expert, but what you do in DNSSec is you assign the answer a DNS server sends to you, so you know that the answer is a legitimate answer. And in a BGPSec, you basically perform the same action. So you sign the announcement, and the other side can verify that it was you who signed the announcement, so you can assume that it is a valid announcement.
Okay, thank you. And while we're waiting for other questions, I have a couple for you. First off, since we're NanoGeo is kind of targeted toward the students, what are the career prospects look like in the field? I mean, you hear all these kind of dire things on the news about security breaches here and there and here and there. So, I mean, this must open up a lot of career opportunities. And if so, what are those career opportunities?
Well, I think previously security was always more on the application side or on the desktop side. So you needed for example, if you talked about security, it was about the virus scanners, intrusion detection, firewalls, etc. But I think it going forward, it's really important, or it becomes more important to also look at the foundation. So in internet, obviously, BGP is the foundation because you can secure or put in as many firewalls as you like. But if the foundation isn't good, then that doesn't really matter. So from that perspective, I would definitely recommend folks who are now studying or looking into how networking and in particular internet networking works to always keep in mind that it's not just routing, but it's also securing that routing and making sure that, well, in this case, announcements are indeed valid. And there's obviously lots of more other work to do as well, right? In the presentation, I touched on, for example, AS path validation. That's the next big thing, right? So definitely look into that. And even if you have ideas, contribute. And that contributing to, let's say, new standards or improving standards is definitely something that can help your career.
Thank you. And then one other question. You're talking about so much from a technology standpoint. You know, you're a network engineer. Here are the things that you need to be mindful of. Can you just discuss some of the business case scenarios for improved security on your network?
Right. Yeah. So if you look at the example I showed about my Ether wallet, that definitely you can project that to other institutes as well. And imagine it would be a real bank or an insurance company or maybe the tax office, right? I mean, so there's definitely impact you can prevent by implementing routing security. And for lots of the business decision makers, it's a far away story, right? It's not close to them. So try to, in a conversation, try to indeed talk about business impact, revenue impact of a hijack. Most of the, for example, a CFO is always interested in hearing what the impact financially is of something, right? So the story would then be that do not talk about the hijack, but talk about the financial impact. And there's quite a few examples. If I look at myself, when I started implementing RPKI in my own small network, I couldn't email the Dutch police anymore. That is inconvenient in my case, because it wasn't a real issue. But obviously, that can become a real issue if you want to, for example, use voice over IP to inform the police or the emergency, well, the 911 services, etc., if there's a real issue. So that's definitely impacting people's lives and so businesses.
Yeah, thank you. Appreciate that. Are there any other audience questions?
I don't see any questions in the chat.
Okay. Well, then, if that's the case, we again thank you so much for taking your time. We appreciate your supporting NANOG in our community. And for those of you in the audience, we look forward to seeing you in the next webinar and also at NANOG 82, our virtual event, which is coming up in June. So thank you all for participating and have a wonderful day. Mm-hmm.